Good morning, dear brothers and sisters in our Lord Jesus Christ. Today is the fifth Sunday after Easter, also known as Rogate Sunday. Rogate means pray. The watchword of this Sunday and of the week is from Psalm 66, verse 20, and it reads as follows. Praise be to God, who has not rejected my prayer or withheld his love from me. Let us now humble ourselves before the Almighty and start our service in the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us turn to page 2 in our hymnals and follow the order of worship. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Let us confess our sins in the words of the second prayer of confessions. Almighty God, merciful Father, we are troubled and penitent sinners, and so we confess to you all our sins and iniquities with which we have offended you and for which we justly deserve your punishment. But we are sorry for them and repent of them and pray for your boundless mercy, for the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ. Be gracious and merciful to us, poor sinful beings. Forgive us our sins. Give us your Holy Spirit for the amendment of our sinful lives, and bring us to life everlasting. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake, forgive us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory to God in the high. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O merciful and everlasting God, Heavenly Father, who through your Son promise us that whosoever we ask in your name, you will give us. We pray you, keep us in your word and grant us your Holy Spirit to protect us from the power of the devil and inspire us to worship you with undistracted hearts. You know how our minds wander with worries and many other things. Help us to put those thoughts away and to focus on you and your glory. Give us your Holy Spirit so that our hearts, souls, minds, and strength may exalt only your holy name. O Lord, you know the multitudes of our sins and our shortcomings. Help us to hate sin and grow more in the Spirit and in prayer, and may the seeds of your word, which will be scattered among us this morning, fall on fertile soil, and let us hear your word with ears of faith, turn to you, know your will, and repent of our transgressions and iniquities. We pray in the name of our risen Lord and Redeemer, Jesus Christ, your beloved Son. Amen. We will now listen to the scripture readings.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Our psalm reading is taken from Psalms 92, and it reads as follows. It is good to praise the Lord, to make music to your name, O Most High, proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the 10-stringed lyre and the melody of the harp. for you make me glad by your deeds, Lord. I sing for joy at what your hands have done. How great are your works, Lord. How profound your thoughts. Senseless people do not know, fools do not understand, that though the wicked spring up like grass, and all evildoers flourish, they will be destroyed forever. But you, Lord, are forever exalted. For surely your enemies, Lord, surely your enemies will perish. All evildoers will be scattered. You have exalted my horn like that of a wild ox. Fine oils have been poured on me. My eyes have seen the defeat of my adversaries. My ears have heard the rout of my wicked voice. The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like the cedar of Lebanon. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green. Proclaiming the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no wickedness in him. Here ends our Psalms reading.
Good morning, dear congregation and listeners. Our epistle reading is taken from 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 6. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 6, and it reads as follows. First of all, I ask you to pray for everyone. Ask God to help and bless them all, and tell God how thankful you are for each of them. Pray for kings and others in power so that we may live quiet and peaceful lives as we worship and honor God. This kind of prayer is good, and it pleases our God, our Savior. God wants everyone to be saved and to know the whole truth, which is there is only one God, and Christ Jesus is the only one who can bring us to God. Jesus was truly human, and he gave himself to rescue all of us. God showed us this at the right time. Here ends our epistle reading. Thank you.
Our gospel reading is taken from Luke chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. The heading, Jesus teaching on prayer. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation. Then Jesus said to them, suppose you have a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have no food to offer him. And suppose the one inside answers, do not bother me. The door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek, you will find. Knock, the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Here ends our gospel reading.
Return to the Lord your God, For he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Hallelujah. Let us now, in the union with the whole church on earth, confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostle Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We now invite the Grace Notes Choir to give us a selection.
Thank you. Good morning, brothers and sisters. It's a delight to be here. I wish you were here in front of me, but you're virtually in front of me, so I'm going to rejoice and say that's great. It's been a while, and we're all doing the best we can, and it's good that we can come together and just look at Scripture and be encouraged and strengthened this morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Kevin Zwart. I'm a missionary with Africa Inland Mission living here in Windhoek, part of the congregation at Inner City Church, and just honored to be able to open the Word with you this morning. So if you'll just pray with me quickly, we'll get started. Father, we just thank you for your love and your grace on us. And we just ask that you will just open your Word, calm our hearts, help us to concentrate, and just to hear from your Spirit this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning's scripture is taken from Matthew 6, verses 5 through 15. And it's a very familiar section of scripture. Most of us know the Lord's Prayer. We say it every Sunday. We've learned it in confirmation class. We say it at home at night, maybe with our children. But it's such a rich piece of scripture. And this morning we're going to talk about that and where it comes from, who Jesus is talking to, what are the meanings behind the phrases that are meant there, and how it can become something a little more deeper for us, as it did for me as I studied this, which was wonderful. But before we go and jump into that, I want to just talk about liturgical worship, because what we do in the Lutheran Church, as well as Catholic churches and Orthodox churches, is we have certain phrases, sermons, creeds that we do every Sunday, things that we repeat to give us strength, to give us encouragement, to ground us in our faith and the truth of what we believe. And the prayer that Jesus gives is one of those key things that is integral in many churches around the world. One thing that we loved when we came to Lutheran Church here, the inner city, was the fact that there were things from Cammie's background in a Presbyterian church, my background in Connecticut in a Methodist church, where there were things that were similar. There are things that united us with the body of believers here. And part of those things were the liturgical pieces of a service. There are other types of worship that we do. We have informal worship. You have private worship in your home. There's informal worship that's done. You'll see churches that are very fluid and kind of, you know, they go all over the place with their worship. And all of those things are good. But the liturgical things have a certain grounding for us. And I think the Lord's Prayer is one of those important things that we really need to understand to become strengthened and encouraged by it. So I'm excited to be able to do this. It was fun for me to study this for the last couple weeks. And then when Pastor Brian asked me to give a sermon on it, it's been a joy. So I hope that it brings you encouragement and the Lord speaks to you. The context of this section of scripture that we find in Matthew 6 is the tail end of the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5 and 6 is called the Sermon on the Mount. And there's a lot in there. Scholars basically agree that the Sermon on the Mount was not this marathon sermon that Jesus gave. Matthew is actually compiling important, critical things that Jesus taught throughout his walking through Galilee. And then he put them in scripture here in a way that these are the things that we need to know. These are the things we need to concentrate on. These are the things that every disciple needs to hear. And the Lord's Prayer and what Jesus said right before the Lord's Prayer are just one piece of it. So the context is important. The only other gospel where we find the Lord's Prayer is in Luke. And there we find possibly the actual circumstance of it. In Luke chapter 11, Jesus is outside of Bethany. He had just visited Martha and Mary. And the scripture says he returned from a certain place where he was praying. If you read your scriptures, you'll see throughout scripture, Jesus went off on his own to go pray to his Father. And here we have a circumstance where Jesus comes back to the disciples and they turn to him and they say, Jesus, John the Baptist taught his disciples how to pray. Can you teach us how to pray? And in Luke, we find the same almost identical wording that we find in Matthew. So we kind of see the context of where this was coming from. This is something that Jesus was giving his disciples. It wasn't something strange or awkward. Most rabbis during that time, they would have their group of disciples and they would teach them their own style or their own phraseology or their own method that they thought of communicating with their Creator and their Father God. So that's important to understand. The other context that we need to understand is prayer was nothing new to the Judeo world. The Jews had prayed and had prayers for over 2,000 years, and just 1,000 years. And they were part of how they conducted their services in the synagogue. When I actually researched that a little bit, I think I came up with 10, 15, 20 just instantly. And there's only a couple I want to point out to us, because I think if we see how Jesus created or formulated this Lord's Prayer, his prayer, many will say it's the disciples' prayer. The Lord's Prayer was something different at in Gethsemane when he's praying to the Father, but this was actually for the disciples. But anyway, it's interesting that Jesus didn't create something brand new. We see a lot of similarities in the Hebrew prayers and in what Jesus taught the disciples. The first one that we find is the Kaddish, which is a prayer of sanctification, basically asking God to forgive us for our sins. We find the Shema, which is the evening prayer. And these prayers are said in synagogues to this day. So, you know, maybe 2,500 years later, they're still saying the same prayers to ground them, like our liturgies, to give them strength and structure and to deepen their faith, which is pretty amazing. But in both of those, the Kaddish and then the Shema, we find hallowed be thy name. That phrase is in both of those prayers and in others, but in those prayers specifically, it's almost like Jesus is kind of drawing from his disciples' heritage. Many of his followers would have been Jews at that time, and they are also using phrases that were similar that the people would understand. In the Shemona Ereshreh, it begins with our Father. And many of the Jewish prayers begin with our Father. They would see God as their Father, the progenitor of their religion and of their faith and of them as a people. And they also have 19 petitions, just like in the Lord's Prayer, there's certain petitions that are made. So all those parts would not be strange to the disciples. And then there's another one called the Amida, which is a standing prayer. When a Jew would go to the synagogue, he would stand and he would silently say a prayer, recite it in his mind, getting himself right before God. So we see that prayer is something that wasn't foreign. It wasn't something that rabbis wouldn't tweak and mold and try to teach maybe new phrases or ways that they can worship and speak to their God. Which is pretty, to me, that it makes it more real that Jesus used real things from real time frames with real people. But let's look now, let's turn to Matthew 6. And let's look at the scripture and what Jesus said to his disciples. Matthew 6, verse 5, says this. When you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Notice that Jesus, first thing he does, according to the Sermon on the Mount, before he gives his formula or his Lord's Prayer, is he has people check their motive. He says, don't be a hypocrite. Don't pray to me because it's the right thing to do. Don't pray to me because someone told you to do it. Don't pray to me so others will see you. Actually, he's saying, go alone. Go be quiet. Go somewhere where no one's going to interrupt you, where you can just talk to the Father. I find that really challenging. We see a lot of TV preachers. We know people who love to say things in groups, who love to pray out loud and use lots of words. And yet Jesus here is saying, no, that's not what I want you to do. As my disciples, no. If we go on, we could talk about the reward, but that's another sermon. Verse 7 says, and when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Jesus not only challenges the Jews' way of praying, standing in the synagogue, praying on the street corners, making a scene, making it a public demonstration, but he challenges the way the Gentiles pray, because he knows that some of his disciples and believers would have come from Gentile backgrounds. And if you ever read through Acts, you know that there was all sorts of crazy stuff that went on in the Gentile religions, whether it be prostitutes using as a form of worship or bringing in food and sacrificing animals and all sorts of cutting themselves, all sorts of things. And Jesus is saying, don't be like them. You don't have to make this a big show. This isn't to use many words and phrases thinking that God's going to be impressed by your vocabulary. So right away, Jesus sets the tone and says, do you understand who you're talking to? Just a side note, which I was thinking of when I went through this, is I think sometimes we believe that if we pray the right way, God will respond in a certain way. And you've probably even heard maybe a self-declared prophet or a TV evangelist or somebody say, well, if you just do this, this, and this, then God will do A, B, and C. Or if you pray this way, then God will answer you. Or if you bring your tithe to the church, then God's going to bless you. We've all heard that one occasionally. Pay attention to what Jesus is saying here, because he's saying, you know what? Go in secret. Don't let anybody know. If you want people to know and they're going to say, wow, you're really good at prayer, that's your reward. But Jesus here is saying, you know what? It's not about that. God already knows what you're asking for because he's God. So don't think that you can manipulate him. Don't think that you can change his mind. Don't have this idea that if you pray a certain way, he's going to do a certain thing, because he's God and you're not. And he goes right into that, and we're going to see that in the first petition in the Lord's Prayer. But I think it's interesting that we often get caught up in thinking, well, if I do things a certain way, God will do a certain thing. And I think that's a dangerous road to go down. So now we get into the actual prayer. And in verse 9, he says, pray then like this. I find the wording really important. And again, I began talking about liturgy because I love liturgy. It grounds my faith. It gives me unity with other believers around the globe. But Jesus is saying here, pray like this. Don't pray only this. Don't pray just this. But pray like this. Use these parts when you talk to your Father God. And I think that's something we need to take away from. And at the end, I'm going to ask and challenge you to put the Lord's Prayer in your own words, to stop after each phrase and think about what that means to you. Because I think that's part of praying like the Lord's Prayer, not praying it only. If we look at the Lord's Prayer, we find 7 parts. We find 3 petitions in the beginning addressing God, and we find 4 at the end addressing human needs and concerns, and then we have a doxology. The doxology was added within the first century of the early church. And it was something that the church fathers came together and agreed and said, nope, we need to wrap this up. We're going to have this prayer as a unifying thing across all Christians, but let's have a doxology where we can solidify it. But it wasn't included in either Matthew or Luke, just to be clear. So we're going to look now just to go through the 7 different parts of the Lord's Prayer, which you're all familiar with, I'm sure. And then there's a question I have, or 2, for each one that I think the Lord is really pressing on me when I was studying it, because often I've said the Lord's Prayer in a very flippant, quick manner, thinking, well, that's a good prayer, I'll just say that. And I think we need to do more. The first part is, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So there's basically 2 parts to this. Our Father, which is basically Jesus saying, you have an intimate relationship with your Creator. He's not just this foreign, distant God who doesn't care about you, who doesn't love you, who doesn't know you. He's actually your Father who created you. Pray to that one. Think of him that way. But then right on the heels of Our Father, he says, who art in heaven. So he's also saying, but remember, he's not like you. He's holy. He's separate. He's magnificent. He's awesome. So you have to hold those intentions when you come before him. Know that he loves you and he cares for you. Know that he's your Father and he intimately knows you, and you can intimately approach him through this prayer and through any prayer, but also know that he is holy. So give him that respect and honor that he so deserves. The second part, hallowed be their name. Now, I don't know. The word hallowed to me is kind of like, it's one of those English words that nobody uses anymore. So what is the meaning behind that? And the meaning is holy, worshiped, glorified. You know, it's giving him praise for who he is, not what he's done, not how he's answered our prayers, not how he's healed our sickness, not how he's saved our souls, but just for who he is. Taking that first moment when we pray and just saying, you know what? I'm praying to the God of the universe. He deserves some major praise from me, not just a quick something or other. It's just, to me, if we stop, just slow down like we're doing this morning and look at that, it's an amazing, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. It's an amazing way to start. Do we really hold him in reverence when we come to him? Or are we too casual? Or are we too distant, thinking he's beyond our prayers and our words? And I think Jesus is challenging his disciples to do that. The second part is, thy kingdom come. Right away, Jesus challenges what we do. Whose kingdom are we actually wanting to come here on earth? What are we actually working towards? Are we working towards establishing God's ways, God's rule in our spheres of influence? Or are we still kind of doing our own thing the way we want? Making things our little kingdoms. And that's a huge challenge. It's a challenge to many pastors who say, no, but this is my church, my body, my group. And I talk to a lot of pastors, and they struggle with that because they do feel responsible. And many have also come to the point where they said, you know what, but we're part of something bigger. We're part of God's kingdom here in Namibia, in Windhoek, in Africa. And to that is it's a strengthening thing. To be part of a bigger kingdom. But that, Jesus is almost saying, this is your job, thy kingdom come. When you pray to God, do you actually say, yeah, we're all for you, we're establishing your rule, we want you to be over everything in my life, thy kingdom come? Maybe think about it. The other part of that question is, do we really want a ruler? Do we really want someone telling us what to do? Because if you pick up scripture and read your Bible, God is going to be telling you what to do with your life. Give to the poor, feed the orphans and the widows. Forgive 70 times 7, which is ad infinitum. God is telling us what to do. He's ruling us through what he's given in scripture and his Holy Spirit speaking in our lives. Do we really want that? If you struggle with that thought, go talk to Pastor Brian or give me a call. We can talk and pray. The third part is, thy will be done on earth. So not only are we establishing his kingdom and his rule and seeing that in the way that we manage our families, in the way that we treat our wives, in the way that we do our jobs, the way that we are with our schoolmates or in university. But also here, Jesus kind of plunges deeper. He says, but it's also about your will. Do you really want what God wants? Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's tough, folks. I was thinking, you know, my will is to go get some ribs from Steers. I've been really craving that. But my wife really wants chicken from Rocco Mama's or something. Well, I'm going to submit my will to her, because in Ephesians it says I should lay down my life and my will for her because she's my wife. That's a really stupid example. But it kind of gets to the point where if the Holy Spirit speaks to you and says, I really want you not to buy the new car. I want you to keep the old rundown car, and I want you to give that money to the orphanage or to the homeless shelter or tithe it to the church this year. Are you going to submit your will in that way? Or are you going to submit your will and maybe something even more difficult in, you have a marriage that's struggling and God's saying, no, I want you to remain faithful in that marriage. I want you to love him who cheated on you. wow, I know a woman who did that. And she submitted her will because she felt God said, no, love that man until he leaves you. I don't want you to leave him. And it was rough, but she submitted her will. And are we really willing to do that? And it's so we take this prayer that we read so quickly, but if you look at what it's saying, it's tough. It's real things that Jesus was calling his disciples to be, that he's calling us to think about and to do. Thy will be done. Are we really willing to submit our will to what God wants us to do? The fourth part is give us this day our daily bread. Now, I really never stopped or paused to even think about this part until I was studying for you guys. And brothers and sisters, this is another one of those big challenges I found, that daily bread is asking for enough, not plenty, not riches, not wealth, not enough for the next day. This is being content with what you have. And I was like, dang. As an American, we have this tendency to always want to make something better, which is, it's how our whole country was founded, on improving and growing and making better mills to treat cotton and produce tobacco and do this and do that. And it's part of our ethos of what we do. Good work ethic, but we always want to make things better, and we always want more. And it's become this sick thing now where we want the bigger house and the better car and more prestige. And Jesus is saying, no, give us today our daily bread. Give me enough today, God, because I will be content with that. Whew. How many of us have bank accounts and savings accounts where we say, well, if I only had another 50 or 100,000 in the bank account, I'll be okay. There's a really wealthy church that supports us in New York. New York? No, they're in Connecticut, actually. And I remember talking to the pastor, and I said, you have a lot of wealthy people that run businesses in Manhattan, stockbrokers and all these guys. And I said, does that help all the things that you're able to do in the church through their tithing and their offerings? He's like, yeah, absolutely. He goes, but you know what? When I meet with them one-on-one, they're still not happy. They're still not content with what they have. The majority of them still think, well, if only I had a little bit more, if only I had a little bigger house, then my family would be happy. If only I went on more vacations, my wife would love me more. If only, if only, if only. I think Paul, in Philippians, you see him talking about being content in all circumstances. He can be our role model. Jesus, who had nothing. It's a huge challenge to all of us. Right there, smack in the middle of the Lord's Prayer. Give me today my daily bread, and I'm good. I'll walk away. That's a tough call. I challenge you to think about that one. But then maybe we get to the hardest part, where he says, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Some versions say debt. Some modern versions say sin, which is basically what Jesus is saying. You need to ask for that, because you sin daily, if not moment by moment, with our faulted nature. But Jesus actually lays it out in here. He says, you know what? The way that you forgive other people is the same way that God's going to apply it to you. Ugh. Now, I have been blessed. I have not had that many people attack or hurt me or trespass or sin against me. I've had a few, and some of them are very hard to forgive. Some of it takes time for God to work on your heart and soften you where you can see them for being created in the image of God and letting it go. Some of you have been hurt repeatedly. Some of you have been abused. Some of you have been mistreated by your own parents or uncles. Or there's things that happen in our lives that are hard to let go. But Jesus is saying here, he's like, you know what? As my disciple, if you're going to be my follower, when you pray, you better ask for forgiveness, but realize that God's going to forgive you in the same manner that you forgive everyone else. This is not you get a free ride. I expect you, because of the way God's forgiven you, to treat others the same way. He actually mentions it in the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 5 as well. It's something really important to Jesus, that we respond to the way that we've been forgiven to other people. Now, I have a confession. It took me many, many years to figure this out, because I grew up in a very good church with a great pastor, great teaching, had a vibrant relationship with the Lord, but I still thought that I did things for God. I would forgive people so God would be happy with me. I would treat people kindly, so therefore God would be kind towards me. And it was 15 or 20 years ago now, but I can specifically remember the time where it finally dawned on me that that's backwards. It's completely backwards to the way Jesus operated. He said, because you've been forgiven, and Paul talks about it all throughout Romans and into Ephesians and into other chapters. He talks about the way you've been forgiven motivates you to forgive others. You don't forgive others so you can be forgiven. And here in the scriptures, we find Jesus saying, just remember that, because if you hold things back, God's going to do the same with you. But because you've been forgiven, you should want to forgive. You have that in you now. And I think that changed my life. It freed me from a lot of guilt. And I hope it does from you too, because forgiving is hard. But once we fully realize how much God has forgiven us, we can apply it to others much more easily. The last part, lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil, I think is a very simple crying out for help. Jesus is saying, you're going to need help from your Father. So you better ask him. Do we want to be delivered from temptation? I remember hearing a speaker once talking about, you know, we really actually like to sin. We really do. So don't fool yourself thinking, well, I hate sin. Sin is awful. If you're still holding on to that piece of temptation, or if you're still holding on to that a little bit too much alcohol that you drink on the weekends, or the way your eye wanders down the street after some woman, you're still enjoying the sin. So don't fool. You're not fooling anybody. And when you pray the Lord's Prayer and you say, lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil, you better mean it. Because God means it. And he wants what's best for you. And again, if we don't realize how far we are from God, how sinful we are, how much he's forgiven and loved us and enveloped us in his love and given us his Holy Spirit as believers, we're not going to forgive. We're not going to run from temptation. And we're going to struggle daily. So to close, I just want to mention a couple things. I've probably gone on too long. I was originally going to say things to take home, but you're already at home, so I hope you enjoyed your coffee and having a good morning today. But maybe take these things to heart. The next time you're going to go pray the Lord's Prayer, and the next time you're going to have your morning devotions or quiet time, whatever you call it, go somewhere where you won't be interrupted. And take Matthew 6 and read through the Lord's Prayer and put it in your own words. If Father, our Father, doesn't have the great connotation, maybe your father was a jerk, I don't know, what word would you use in Oshivambo or Herero? What word has the sentiment of a loving, caring, all-powerful Father to you? Pray that. Check your heart. Check your motivation. If you're uncomfortable praying alone, why? Do you need to pray in front of other people? Why is that? I would love to hear stories of people during this strange, difficult time of finding more time alone with God. I know it's been a struggle for me because I have worries just like you do. But it pushes me to want to be with him. Know who you're talking to. He is the holy, awesome creator of this universe that we cannot imagine or fathom. So as you draw close to your Father, also give him glory for who he is. And as we say, as your kingdom come, your will be done in heaven and earth, asking yourself, what part isn't he ruling over? Are you still doing things from tradition or from what some self-help book told you or from what somebody told you, and you know it's not quite right? Challenge your motivation for how you're establishing God's kingdom. Do you really want his kingdom to come? Are you really doing things in your life that are ushering in a new way of doing things? Read through Matthew 5 and 6. Are you forgiving? Are you loving? Are you being meek? Are you being humble? Are you being that person that's establishing the kingdom of God around you? Are we truly content with enough when we ask for daily bread? Or are we still in the back of mind saying, yeah, I'll take the daily bread, but I'd really like ribs. We need to be content. We need to find that peace that is in contentment. And I think really importantly is forgive and forgive and forgive because we've been forgiven. Not because it's an order, not because it'll earn us anything, but because the way God has loved and forgiven us, we can forgive anyone. And I think we need to do that. And then lastly, cry out to him for help. Lead us not in temptation. Deliver us from evil. These times are uncertain. These times are frightening. And some people are really suffering. Around the globe, this isn't an isolated incident anymore. So let us cry out for him for help. Lead me not to be tempted to doubt you, God. That's what I'm praying. I pray that you find the Lord's Prayer to be something deeper and more affirming and strengthening to you during this time. Know that I'm with you. My family and our missionary families in Namibia all chose to stay in Namibia to help during this time. None of them went back to their home countries. Because we love Namibians, we love each other, we love our body of Christ here. Let us support each other. Let us pray for one another. And may God bless you. Amen.
Once again, we invite Grace Notes Choir for a second selection.
Bonga, bonga, winna, for sending three.
closing prayer, we will have a responsive prayer with a request. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Thou, your grace may seem slow. We trust, O Lord, that you will grant us all things needful in their proper time. Just as you have brought your own Son in the fullness of time to be our Savior. Grant us patience and humility, that we may not despair or grow weary of waiting, but live by faith and prayer each day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Almighty and everlasting Father, guardian of our lives, strengthen those who preach, teach, and pray, those who seek the lost, those who keep vigil with the dying, and all who minister to your people. Raise up many who will speak your word to us, faithful workers and preachers who will bring hope and light to those who live in the shadow of death and the darkness of it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
God of love, empower us with your Holy Spirit to love and to search for you with our whole heart, soul, strength, and mind. Help us also to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Let us be advocates of goodwill and ambassadors of hope. Make us agents of peace in the world, so that the promises of Christ may be fulfilled. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Put to death, O Father, all which is evil within us, so that we may not practice immorality or idolatry, nor give into temptation of anger, hate, corruption, or deceit. Help us to put off the old self and to live as the new people you have made us to be by our baptism into Christ Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
God of peace, your word tells us that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin brings your reproach. Keep our country and its people under your care. Bless our nation and all the nations of the earth, that we may have good and wise leaders who will seek your will and walk in your ways. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We praise you that in the midst of the deadly COVID-19, no one has lost his or her life in our country, and that no new infections has been recorded. Thank you, Father, that you gave us God-fearing leaders who always stand to you, both in good and in bad days. We pray also for our neighboring countries and all the nations of the world, that you will also bring healing to them and show your love and mercy to all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Guard and defend our homes, that parents may be kept in the bonds of love and godliness, and may raise their children well, nourishing them in truth and in the fear of your holy name. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Give comfort, O Heavenly Father, especially to the sick and suffering, to those who mourn, the aged, the lonely, the infirm, and the dying. We pray to you on behalf of all whom we remember and name now in our hearts. Carry us through this affliction by your grace, and bring them to everlasting life, when all troubles and trials shall cease, and we shall know perfectly your healing, joy, and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
These and all things good and needful grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive now the benediction of the Lord, and go in peace. The Lord will bless you and keep you. The Lord will make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord will look upon you with mercy, favor, and love, and give to you his peace. In the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I'll be reading from Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. It's under the heading, Robbing God. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. For offering, the finance committee would like to share the banking details for the church as per below. Thank you.